Morning, church.
Good morning.
The song we'll be singing is Go Tell It on the Mountain.
Amen.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ was born.
Go tell him.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ was born.
Go tell them.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ was born.
When I was a seeker, I stumbled night and day. I asked the Lord to help me, and He showed me the way.
Go tell
them.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ was born.
Go tell them.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ was born. He made me a watchman across a city wall. And if I am a Christian,
okay,
at least I'm one of all.
Go tell them.
Go tell it on the mountain. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Youth Choir. We worked really hard on that song. It is now the time we've been waiting for, the sermon. I ask that everybody please stand as we welcome our Reverend Lembo. Amen.
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 Let me bow our heads for prayer. Almighty Father, we thank you, Lord, for bringing us once again before your throne of grace to be fed with your words. We thank you, Father, for the privilege we have in you, Lord. As we are about to be fed with your words, we say in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, to please anoint your message. Sanctify the tongue that will deliver it, Father, speak through me. Consecrate the hearts that will hear the message, O Lord. Let each word that is sown this morning find fertile ground in our hearts, O Lord. Do not let us be hearers alone, but do us of thy work. And end of this message, Father Almighty. Let each and every one of us have every cause to glorify your holy name. We thank you, Lord, for this privilege. We glorify your holy name, Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, Father, we pray.
Amen.
Can you sit there, please? Yeah, good morning, church.
Good morning.
Today is the day the Lord has blessed.
Amen.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen.
I'm happy to be here this morning. I feel great. I don't know about you.
Amen.
And we use this opportunity to welcome back again our dear mother, sister, pastor, Dr. Evangeline Maka.
Good morning.
Welcome in our midst.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Because our spirit never departed from you. The theme of our message this morning is take up your cross and follow me. Take up your cross and follow me. Yeah, I want us to open our Bible to the sermon, which is John chapter 17. John chapter 17. And I will be reading from verse 6 to 19, which is going to be the background of our message this morning. John 17, from verse 6. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them to me, and they have kept thy word. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. For I have given unto them the words which thou givest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me. For they are thine, and all mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorifying them. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee, Holy Father. Keep through thy own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them is lost but the son of perdition, that the scriptures might be fulfilled. And now come I to thee, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in them, in themselves. I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou should take them out of the world, but that thou should keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. May God bless his holy word.
Amen.
Take up your cross and follow me. When Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me, I wonder, what do we understand it, or how do we take it? I want us to first begin with what Jesus did not mean. What Jesus did not mean. Many people interpret a cross as some burden they must have to carry in their lives. A strained relationship, a thankless job, a physical illness. With self-pity and pride, they say, that's my cross I have to carry. How many times have we resorted to comforting ourselves when we find ourselves in a hopeless situation? But when we involuntarily resign to a deplorable situation, instead of summing up our courage and get out of it by asking God for help, you are in a relationship with a selfish, uncaring husband who abandoned you and your children. Instead of seeking advice on best actions to take, you decide to saddle yourself with the responsibility of raising up your children by comforting yourself with, that's my cross. You end up struggling with the children you can no longer control because of their poor upbringing. The Bible advised we parents in Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. No matter what trial or crisis we may be going through, We must always remember to lean on Christ and don't resign to self-pity. And seeking advice and consolation from fellow humans who are equally struggling for their salvation and refusing to take advantage of the places where you could be equipped and armed with the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Many are gainfully employed in a job which denies them of the opportunity to serve God they cry to when looking for a job. And as soon as they get that job, instead of looking for another job or pray to God for intervention, they decide to forgo church because to them, that's their cross. They have to carry, I am sorry. They get it all wrong. It's not your cross, but the burden which Satan wants you to carry with your consent. Some people blame their decision not to come to church again because the pastor of the church fails to meet their demands. Do we come to church to worship the pastor or to worship Christ? If Christ did not fail to meet your demands, why not then focus on Christ as your main purpose of coming to church to serve God and not succumb to the wishes of man? Men will fail you when their expectations are not met, but Christ will remain constant and still love you unconditionally. When Jesus carried his cross to Golgotha to be crucified, no one was thinking of the cross as a heavy burden. In the first century, the cross was invented by the Egyptians, which they used as a punitive punishment to runaway slaves or hardened criminals. The cross was the worst type of capital punishment that could be passed on anybody. The unfortunate victim is made to carry the cross from the courthouse to the place of crucifixion along a rugged road, while he would be spitted upon and different types of measles like eggs or rotten tomatoes, and even urine would be thrown at him apart from all sorts of insults and cursing. That was a cross that our Lord Jesus Christ volunteered to carry for all humanity. Amen. So that we can all be saved. Our Lord Jesus had to surrender himself to this agonizing and horrible death experience, all because of you and me. But why did he have to do it? Have you ever taken time to think why Jesus had to volunteer to undergo such painful and humiliating death as a ransom for our sins, which our first parents, Adam and Eve, committed, and hence sentenced us all into slavery under sin? How could such a righteous man, who had never committed any crime or sin, volunteer to pay with his life for the sins committed by another? I wonder if today we could still find any father or any mother who will volunteer to go to jail for sins committed by his or her child. And that is different from volunteering to be hanged for the murder committed by their child. But what do we have today? A father who would prefer to spend $1 million to a donor for his kidney for his sick son rather than donating one of his own two kidneys. A young woman refused to donate her own kidney to save our mother's life. And why? She was afraid because she would lose her life. She consoled herself by saying, well, my mom had lived her life and I will give her a befitting burial if she dies. The old woman refused to die because after she realized the limit of her daughter's love, she turned to Jesus for total dependence, and she lived to ripe old age. Yeah. Hallelujah! Yeah. Many people have experienced the miraculous in their lives and beat death after realizing their mistake of relying on humans and treating every disappointment as their cross to which they have to resign and die miserably in self-pity. That is not a cross that the Lord wants you to carry. and follow him. Rather, he said in Matthew 11, 28 to 29, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and lean of me, for I am weak and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. If Christ will give you rest from your toil and sufferings, then what cross did he mean, and who is Jesus? Jesus is the Son of God, we all know. He is the Messiah. He is the way and the truth and the door to our salvation.
Yes, yes.
Was he the Messiah in the Old Testament prophets? Prophesied as the hope of Israel? Are all the prophecies fulfilled in his life and teachings? These are the testimonies that all believers and genuine Christians should be able to justify from the Holy Bible. It was